representative Frank Betson just a moment. Starting lineups for both teams. First, the visitors from Guelph. At left wing, number 71, Hunter Brazier. At center for the Griffins, number 15, Ethan Doyle. And at right wing is number 12, Emmett Gordon. On defense for Guelph, number 7, Duncan Pinman. And at right defense, number 24, Liam Hamm. And in the goal is number 33, Brendan Creedon. The Griffins head coach is Josh Dixon. He's assisted by associate coach Dave Leader and assistant coach Scott Simmons. And now, let's meet the starting lineup for the engineers of RPI. Remove your hats as the RPI pep band plays the national anthems of Canada and the United States of America.
Hey! Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome inside the Houston Fieldhouse on the campus of RPI. It's time once more for Engineers Hockey here on RPI TV. This afternoon, it's the second half of the season-opening exhibition weekend for the RPI men's hockey program. Yesterday, they picked up a shootout victory over the Union College Garden Chargers. Today, an exhibition match against a team from U Sports. It is the University of Guelph Griffins in town for a Sunday matinee. Alongside former RPI men's hockey head coach Dan Pridgen, I'm Dan Ball. Thanks so much for joining us this afternoon here on RPI TV. And coach, we saw the men's team on the ice for the first time for the 2023-24 regular season as they took down Union in a shootout. What did you make of game one, and what do you expect here from game two?
Well, I thought the play, a good pace of play for the first game. I didn't think either team ran out of gas. And, we had a little bit of everything, special teams, overtime, and shootout. I would say we had everything.
Never a bad thing to be able to practice all of the skills at once, and that's exactly what we saw as RPI finished regulation in a 2-2 draw with Union. Teams went through the 5-minute overtime period. Nobody scored in that one, though. The Engineers got very close as Tyler Hodson rang one off the post, but it did not go, so the two teams needed shootout to settle things, and that's where RPI won by a 2-0 margin to pick up their unofficial first victory of the season. We're ready to go. The puck is down at center here at the Houston Fieldhouse as the Engineers in their home white jerseys go from right to left across your screen. They start the goaltender who picked up the victory in the cage yesterday. That is Jack Watson. Watson, the starter in a number of games last year. He's the junior out of Toronto, Ontario. Played the third period in yesterday's game as well as overtime and the shootout. Seeded one goal in the early going of the third to Ethan Benz about a minute and a half or so in. And that was it on his ledger. Meanwhile, here come the Engineers 3-on-2 led by Regula. CJ Regula started on defense with Nick Ardanaz. It was Finn Brown, John Beaton, and Brendan Booty starting up front. There's a big hit laid by Duncan Penman, and slow to get up there was Booty at the end of his shift. Meanwhile, it's the Griffins who start their breakout, deflected deep into the zone. Poked away there by Watson as Ethan Doyle was oncoming. It was Doyle centering the starting line of Hunter Brazier and Emmett Gordon. Duncan Penman, Liam Hamm on defense. And netminder Brendan Cregan in the cage. Cregan, a fifth-year player playing in his fourth season. Out of Hammonds Plains, Nova Scotia, sent on goal, saved by Watson, the rebound controlled. Ryan Brichette was back and corralled that rebound, and now RPI will start their breakout.
Good test for RPI as far as stick discipline is concerned. The visiting team, Guelph University Griffins, are wearing a half shield as they do in the Canadian University League.
The setup of the Canadian Leagues, and as it's often called, U Sports, or in this case, the OUA, the Ontario University Athletics, is a bit different in that sense, as you'll have a number of players. Pretty much every player on this roster came from a team in either the WHL, OHL, or QMJHL, which are the main junior leagues in Canada, as opposed to the leagues where you see players go and then come and play Division I college hockey. These are all eligibility-related conversations. So more on that as we move through it. But you get a different brand of hockey player with often 3 to 4 years worth of considerable junior experience under their belt coming in.
Yeah, no question. So in other words, they're not amateurs. If you play in the Quebec Major Junior or any of those major junior leagues over in Canada, you get paid to play. And the other difference is that when you go to a Canadian university, you get 5 years to play.
So you'll see players ranging from year one to year five. It's ironic that we're reaching the end of the time where Division I players are getting that same kind of eligibility. As the shot from Ian Ferguson is deflected up and out of play, we'll get a whistle just over 3 minutes into the first. And it's really the one time in history where you could say the NCAA matches it with the fifth-year eligibility due to COVID. But very interesting. You get two very different brands of hockey, I should say, between what we saw with Union yesterday and what we're seeing here today.
Yeah, well, with that COVID going out, You will go back to only having 4 years eligibility. You have 5 years to play four once you matriculate and go to classes at the university level. The other thing is that you can play 3 years in the NCAA, go back to a Canadian university, and play two more.
That is an interesting note there as well, as you have some players who will get through part of their eligibility as the puck rebounds up and into the engineer's bench, so we'll have a stoppage who may not see the future or may want to change things up. And so the roster constitution for a lot of these teams in OUA is very unique compared to a relatively similar system across a lot of Division I teams here in the United States. But anyways, that's what we'll be watching in front of us here today, as the Griffins on the season 1-3. They played three non-conference games to begin their season. Picked up a victory in their season opening game in a rather unique way. More on that in a moment. It was a 1-0 lead in total, as that one sent on goal, handled by Cregan. Taken back the other way by the Griffins, but stolen by Ardenas. RPI looking to get some chances in transition, sent on goal. That one's handled by Watson. He will hang on and take a faceoff just under 4 minutes into the opening period with no score.
Good play by the RPI D to break that play up, and then they end up turning it back over, and a good shot on goal by the Griffins.
Just buttoning that thought, the Griffins won a game 1-0 against Carleton. They were awarded the win after Carleton had an ineligible player on their roster. So that was how the Griffins picked up win number one on the year. They lost games to Ottawa, Brock, and Nipissing. Am I saying that correctly? Nipissing there?
Yep. Yeah, you are.
Watson will handle that one. I always go to my resident Canadian for words that I don't necessarily recognize, but that was the first game that they played in OUA competition. So officially an 0-1, you could call it conference record. Faceoff to the right of Watson is won by Dovar Tinling. Tinling and Hodson, the two goals in consecutive attempts in the shootout yesterday as part of the shootout victory over Union for this team. Finn Brown scored the game-opening goal for RPI midway through the opening period. The game was volleyed back and forth from 1-0, 1-1, 2-1, and 2-2. The other goal being credited to Altti Nikkanen before we hit the extra frame. Stolen away and sent through the neutral zone, wobbling end over end. Smolinski the first one there. Smolinski feeling the pressure of the oncoming Gio Biondi. On and off the tape of Jeremy Piant, as Piant will pick it up on the backhand. 3-on-3 come the engineers, deflected off of a stick of a defender as Piant's pass ended up being a chance toward the goal. Ended up missing high and wide, but Lucas Matta wins the forecheck. Puck was loose there for the moment, still wobbling around. Sent wide of the cage as the viewfinder off there for Matta. He has it again, top of the circles, in and out of the glove of Cregan. Rebound scooped up by Payant, covering the far point. Smolinski, who was working the sideboard, will go all the way through the top of the zone and send a shot on goal that got deflected into the corner. Kept in at the line by Payant. He'll go lengthwise. Shot from Smolinski. He scores! Max Smolinski opens the scoring just over 5 minutes into the opening period. RPI up a goal.
Well, that was just a great play. RPI was hemming him in the zone and moving that puck around really, really well. And it was a nice pass by Payant over to Smolinski, who snuck in there. And it looked like it might have hit a stick, but it goes 5-hole on the goaltender, Cregan.
Was wondering if, and if so, whom it took a deflection off of. But it ended up in the back, back of the net nonetheless. Max Smolinski, the sophomore out of Bloomfield Hills, Michigan, 3 goals and 14 points in 35 games last season as a first-year defenseman on the roster for Dave Smith. Smith spoke very highly of Smolinski in terms of his expectations for the upcoming season, a player you'll see get a lot of time leading the power play unit, or quarterbacking it, so to speak, but will play in all three situations one would expect, is Danny Ciccarello leading the forecheck. Puck loose, picked up at the top of the slot. McNeil, first shot blocked, rebound, score! If at first you don't succeed, try again. And the freshman, Brad McNeil, makes it 2-0 Engineers just like that.
Oh, good play by McNeil. He didn't turn away from the shot at all. He stayed right with it, followed his shot. Next thing you know, see him follow it, picks it up again, and sends it far side. It's like past the blocker of Cregan. Two quick goals here by RPI.
The first of which from Smolinski, the second of which from McNeil. Brad McNeil, the freshman out of Royal Oak, Michigan. So a very strong start to the game for that state, as the Engineers have two goals in just over the first 6 minutes. Took RPI about 35 minutes or so to put together their first two goals yesterday. Meanwhile, the other way come the Griffins, led in by DeSimone. Jonah DeSimone has it at the near side point. Protected by Kutkevicius, he'll take a tour and send that one off of Watson. A shot that caught Watson down in the butterfly. Save made on the shot from the point. Rebound loose at the top of the circles. Pulled free by Beaton and nudged back out to the neutral zone.
That looked like it might have went off the post.
I was wondering the same thing. I didn't see the immediate washout from the official, but it looked like that may be the case. Meanwhile, here comes Hotson. Cuts to the forehand. Couldn't get the shot away. Finds it again. Now Brichette. He can't get the shot either, as last-ditch defense being played by the Griffins to try to keep this game at a two-goal deficit. Taken away on a couple of nice skill plays by Max Molinsky. Brichette gains the line, knocked through the legs by Hotson, sent a space pass in the direction of Delmar Tinling. Picked up by Hotson. He shoots. That one's knocked aside. Rebound, a scrap for it back behind the cage between Tinling and Hamm. Centering feed was looking for the oncoming Hotson. Puck wobbled its way by, kept in at the line by Tinling. He fights his way in for a shot, and a save made by Cregan. Man, the line of newcomers between Tinling, Hotson, and Ryan Brichette buzzing in the offensive end as we have a whistle with just under 8 minutes gone by in the first.
Yeah, those guys have been buzzing pretty well. Evans as well on that line.
Payant, Evans, and Brackett the line for the offense for the Engineers, but it's stripped away from Surdy. The other way come the Griffins, centering feed. Got blocked down as Nolan Forster was ahead of the defense by a step, but he couldn't catch the pass. Never came. Battle in the near corner as it's knocked away by Forster from Laurie Surdy.
That was a good stick by Lucas Mata. I think he was able to poke that puck away. That's why he couldn't get the pass off.
Evans will send it back behind Watson's cage. 2-0 Engineers. Thanks for joining us here on RPI TV for our opening weekend of exhibition games. RPI will hit the road for a considerable amount of time after this weekend. Opening up the regular season with non-conference play against a group of Hockey East teams. Payant sends it on goal. Cregan makes the save. Puts the stick in the blocker up to protect himself as Ciccarello was right there in the crease battling for some space, but we'll have a whistle and a stoppage with 11:20 to go in the first in a game that RPI leads by two. One game in league for this Griffins group so far this year. It was a couple weekends back at this point, back on September 23rd, a 2-1 loss. Dangerous pass, but it's picked up by Ardenaz, who will advance in, hit the brakes, and wheel back to his spot at the point. Left for Regula, who walks in on one. That one gets deflected, goes up and above. That was Agnew, pardon me. The 6 and the 8 for the two right-handed defenders. Similar, as that one's knocked off the stick of Agnew, as Zev Podolsky was gaining the neutral zone. It's deflected up and out of play. We'll have a stoppage and a face-off in the neutral zone.
Benny and Ben and Jerry, proud to support RPI Hockey.
This Guelph team, led by first-year head coach Josh Dixon, was hired relatively late into the summer, as Dan Pridgen and I were discussing before the game, June 29th, 2023, considering that you're essentially hired in July and a season will begin in September. That is taking the reins on a program with not a lot of time left in the offseason.
Yeah, and that's what he had mentioned, too, that three of his top players had gone. One went pro, one became a firefighter, and one went had some family issues that he had to deal with, so he took a year off.
Strom takes a hit along the far boards. The puck is knocked loose for Regula, who will pop it high up in the air. This one will wobble its way down and be icing as Duncan Penman wins the race. So the faceoff will come back into the Engineers' defensive ends. It is Dixon's first head coach at the U Sports level, but he comes in with 23 years of experience between Canadian juniors and other various assistant and associate head coaching jobs. Previously spent the last 2 years as an associate head coach with the Prince George Cougars of the WHL. Drive from center ice from the oncoming Brendan Booty was handled by Cregan. Put everything he had into that shot and ended up falling over after it. Knocked around Smolinski and into the corner by Kutkevicius. Centering feed, save made by Watson. Rebound controlled. Knocked to the line, kept in for the moment, but on second attempt, RPI is able to complete their clear. The puck is sent over the blue line, but the play was offside, so we'll have a stoppage and a whistle with 9:54 to go in the first period, and we'll hit our mid-period break. 2-0 RPI on goals in the first 6.5 minutes to put the home team in the lead. Back with more after this. You're watching Engineers Hockey on RPI TV. .54 to go first period here in Troy. 2-0 RPI over the University of Guelph Griffins in the second half of a two-game weekend set, exhibition style here at the Houston Fieldhouse. Face-off just outside of the Engineers' offensive end. They've reset this one a couple of times, and a shove from Nolan Forster, and Forster and Dovar Timling are exchanging pleasantries. Faceoff won cleanly then by Timling. Matta for Smolinski. He will send it in deep. He's Dan Pridgen. I'm Dan Ball. Thanks so much for being with us here on this Sunday afternoon. Smolinski will retreat in the neutral zone. His pass got deflected. Forster comes in. Didn't realize his line mate was still in the zone, scrapping with Smolinski. So the play is offside. A whistle and a faceoff back in the neutral zone. 9:38 to go here in the first.
Dan, you mentioned Josh Dixon in his first year. He's got two certainly capable assistant coaches. Dave Leger, who's been around Ontario and had some great coaching jobs. And he is the associate coach along with a former captain of the Griffins, Scott Simmons.
Very important when you talk about a coach that's doing it for the first time at the U Sports level to have, as you mentioned, such capable assistant coaches to help build the program. So in a good place is this group that finished last year with a record of 10-10-7. They finished in a tie for sixth place in the Western Division of the OUA. It came down to the final game. It was interesting reading the recap of what happened last season. Guelph controlled their own fate with a win in their final game of the year called Aggie Night in front of the home crowd of a considerable amount of fans as play is whistled dead. They won their final game but didn't get the bounce they were looking for in terms of other games going on to the OUA West. So they finished in a tie for six with 27 points, but out of the three teams that had 27, only one could make it. So missed the playoffs, and then the change of the coaching staff and a group in a bit of transition here for the visitors. Meanwhile, here is Nick Ardanaz. Sent lengthwise for Nathan Sullivan, who tried to send it low for Gagneau. Knocked around him, a pass to the middle, partial break, and the shot goes over the top of the cage, and the chance from Ian Ferguson. The defender stepped up and was part of the rush. Meanwhile, Ciccarello to his backhand, save, Cregan, rebound, another stop made, third chance to the backhand, Regula, he scores! On transition, it's the defender, C.J. Regula, on the rebound, a three spot for RPI in the first.
Well, he just showed some real good patience there. He could have taken that shot, but there was such a lot of bodies in front of the net. He just held it and took it to his backhand and slid it in the open net. I think everybody was expecting him to take that shot on the forehand. He got five guys right in front of the goaltender, Cregan, who didn't see it at all.
Well, the RPI offense buzzing here in the opening period. Three goals today, that's now more in terms of regulation and overtime than they scored in yesterday's game, as a shot from Strom gets deflected up and over the netting, or into the netting and over the glass.
RPI,
so a stoppage with 8:12 to go in the first. Goals from Smolinski, McNeil, and C.J. Regula here in period one.
I was wondering if it was going to be assisted, because I can't tell you who touched it last.
The words from Al Shibley over the PA, Regula all alone. As you're right, it was nothing but chaos. And good presence by McNeil, who scored the second goal. He was the one at the top of the crease. Meanwhile, a shot coming from Brown was turned aside by Cregan. Long outlet feed on the tape of Jonah DeSimone, but his centering feed was blocked. Now the other way with speed comes John Beaton. Beaton, sharp angle shot, saved by Cregan, no rebound. He'll take a whistle with 7:43 to go in the first. Coach, are you seeing anything different from RPI from an offensive standpoint than we saw in yesterday's game against Union?
Not really. I mean, as usual, what usually happens after a real good scoring opportunity by the opposition, you go down and you score a goal. I mean, great save by Watson on Ferguson, the defenseman from Guelph. But no, they're playing pretty steady.
Picked up at center and sent deep by Jacob Winterton. Knocked back out to the neutral zone, sent in on Watson from right in front of the engineer's bench. He steered that one aside. Winterton again, this time in the far corner. Looks to center a pass, took a hit from Laurie Surdy that jarred the puck loose. Mata gets the breakout rolling. The trailer is Hotson, but he has that one knocked away. Backhanded through the middle from the trailing forward, Brichette. Swept back in deep, good forecheck by the Griffins, able to keep RPI in their own end for a few moments as Hotson has that one jarred free. Griffin Wilson applying pressure, but it's taken away. Now here comes the speedy Jeremy Payant. Payant knifes his way through, tried to get a sneaky shot or pass away. Planked off of a skate, kept in at the line and sent in by Agnew. Payant tried to knock it to the middle. It's knocked down and taken the other way. Picked up in the backhand by Biondi, but it's stolen now. A partial 2-on-1 with trailers. A pass to the middle from Evans. That pass got deflected. RPI trying to turn transition chances into offense, as Ardanaz will force this one in deep in a battle with Podolski.
Yeah, good defensive play by the defender there, Ashton Reeser for University of Guelph.
Lengthwise for Podolski as the Griffins play catch with under 6 minutes remaining here in the first. Pass to the middle from Biondi got stolen. McNeil will drop for the trailing Evans. Here is John Evans shooting, and it wobbles its way just wide. Another good chance as McNeil set that one up with a backhand feed as this one will roll down and be icing against the Griffins with now 5:41 to go here in the first. It'll be interesting to see how this Guelph team puts their offense together, as Dan Frigin mentioned, due to signing professionally, becoming a firefighter, or otherwise, this team lost four of their top six point scorers, as well as their top three of their top four goal scorers, it would appear. So that'll certainly be a work in progress as this visiting squad makes their way through. Sent on goal through a screen, blockered away by Watson. Battle in the near corner as three white sweaters converge on two black sweaters. Pass was nearly stolen by the incoming DeGerse. Meanwhile, here come the Engineers, three on two. The trailer is beaten. He didn't get a shot away. He was the one who was coming off the bench as RPI was in the midst of a change in the middle of their odd man rush. Wobbling, puck left and then picked up at center. Wheeling his way in is Sullivan, shooting from the top of the circles, and a save made by Cregan. He will clamp down on that one with just under 5 minutes to go here in the first, in a game that RPI leads by three.
So Griffin, you know what a Griffin is?
No.
It's a legendary animal. And it has the body, tail, and back legs of a lion, the head and wings of an eagle, with its talons on the front legs, and talons are the claws. So that's what a Griffin is.
That is a heck of a mascot to begin with. Then you take in the fact that it is the, I guess you could call it, old English spelling. Centering feed, knocked in front. Watson was able to use the paddle to block that one as DeSimone was sitting on the back door. Brown fighting to knock this one into the neutral zone. It's kept in, but Matta will take it the other way. It showed it on the graphic right at the beginning of the game, but if you missed it, it's GRYPHONS. Griffins. It's very fascinating all the way around. I very much appreciated the description there, too. I didn't know how many different elements went into the creation of the Griffin.
Yeah, it's got a little bit of everything.
Just like any good hockey player, as that one will be sent down and go for icing against the aforementioned Griffin. So the faceoff will come back into the offensive end. Again, goals in this one for RPI from Max Malinsky, Brad McNeil, and CJ Regula, the sophomore, the freshman, and the transfer on the board for the home team. Faceoff won cleanly by RPI. Laurie Surdy will force it deep. Burchette sent it in the direction of Hodson. It missed him, but Surdy will activate from the point to keep it in. Dovar Tinling tried to shoot around the player in front of him. That was Winterton. That one got blocked, but the Engineers keep the zone. Hodson wheeling on his backhand, goes all the way across the zone. It almost looked as though Tinling didn't expect it to get all the way there. He was about a step behind the play. Hodson protects in the far corner. Pass got deflected. It's taken the other way by Nolan Forster. Through the neutral zone in a hurry. Sharp angle try from Hunter Brazier missed the net. Hodson will knock it around the oncoming defender, Liam Hamm. Meanwhile, here come the Griffins the other way in transition. That shot missed the cage. Hamm back in the neutral zone as Guelph will regroup with 3 minutes exactly to go here in the first. Ardenage tried to knock that one free from Podolsky, unsuccessful, but on second attempt, Payant will knock it into the offensive end and go for a chase of the puck. He was battling with Allinson, kept in at the line as Regula will make a couple of moves. Ardenage, an inside-out move, he'll step in. Pass goes all the way through. Split the uprights between Regula and Payant, the latter of which will gain possession right over his own blue line. Scooped up by Tristan DeYoung. The other way come the Griffins, a shot from the far side. Watson handles that one. Rebound still loose in front, backhanded to the back door. Watson, another save on the chance coming from Griffin Wilson. Payant will lead the rush, flip through the middle, a penalty upcoming. This one will go against the Griffins. With exactly 2 minutes remaining in the first period, that is the length of the power play that the Engineers will be receiving in just a few moments' time.
Yeah, speaking of Josh Griffin, Josh Dixon before the game, head coach of the Griffins, was mentioning that one of the things that they really wanted to cut down on this year, I guess last year they were the most penalized team in the OUA, and I tell you, they've been playing a clean game up until this point.
Number 17, Gio Biondi. He receives 2 minutes for a hook.
You can understand that thought in the OUA opener that Guelph played against Nipissing a couple weeks ago. There were 11 total penalties in that game, 10 minors and a misconduct. So a physical style of play, and a very interesting note there from Dixon. Meanwhile, the Engineers on the power play. Brichette through a screen. That one gets blocked right in the slot. A move one way, then the other from Duncan Penman. Pass gets deflected on its way through the middle. It's backhanded out to the neutral zone. RPI finished 0-for-3 on their power play against Union yesterday. The Garnet Chargers, meanwhile, went 1-for-2. Hodson spins away from trouble. Sent far side for Ardenaz. Tinling will whip it back to the point for Smolinski. Smolinski backs his way to the middle, shoots, blocked by his own man, and a backhand coming from Hodson got blocked as well. Brichette tried to knock it deep for Hodson, backhanded to the line, where Smolinski, who was retreating already, will take a moment to slow things down. Under a minute remaining, first period here in Troy. A successful first already for RPI. Brichette trying to add. That one's poked away. It's under Cregan. No, it's not. It's pulled away by the defense and cleared out to the neutral zone as a bit of a whiffed clearing attempt off of the stick of Ethan Doyle. Still cleared the zone, however, the most important part, as Sullivan spins away from trouble, leaves for Evans. Cross pass for Ardenaz. He snapped his stick. On the one-time attempt, he'll head for a line change as Laurie Surdy will step on. Good pass there from Evans. That was the right one to make as Ardenaz had the chance to get the shot away. Now 10 seconds. Evans for Surdy. Back for Evans, top of the circles, running out of time. One-timer in the direction of the cage and never got on goal. Missed Finn Brown, who was creating traffic, and the horn will sound. Triple zeros on the clock here at the Houston Fieldhouse. A 3-0 lead for the Engineers after 20 minutes of play. Max Smolinski scored the opener from that right-hand circle. Brad McNeil on his own rebound made it 2-0, and then C.J. Ragula, the defender, on good patience, made it 3-0, and Dan Fridgen, that's where we sit after a successful opening period for the home team.
Yeah, good period by RPI. I think one of the things they've done a little different, they're capitalizing on their opportunities, and that's why we have a 3-0 score for them right now.
Before we hit our intermission break, let's take a look back at some highlights from the first period. Dan Fridgen, as it was successful, a couple of goals for RPI. We'll see him right here.
Well, that's just a nice play by Payant over to Max Smolinski, who there, went underneath five hole on him. And then the second one, you've got McNeil staying with his shot. First one is blocked, but he follows up, puts the next one far side. And of course, Ragula coming in and make like he was going to shoot on the forehand, but took it to the backhand to a wide open net.
Pretty impressive for the defender, showing a bit of offensive touch on that backhand. So two defenders in on the scoring and the other being a freshman as the Engineers spread the offense around through their five goals this weekend in regulation. Five different goal scorers, Finn Brown, Altidakin, and now Smolinski, McNeil, and Ragula. And it's RPI in the lead by a three spot after the first 20 minutes of play. We'll step aside and be back with second period action in just a few moments. So stay with us. You're watching Engineers Hockey on RPI TV.
Number 4, junior forward, Anton Safonov. Number 5 is junior forward, Trent Burton. Number 6, graduate defenseman Jonah Witt. Number 7, sophomore defense Michael Benson. Number 8, senior forward Billy Fisher. Junior defenseman number 9, William Mancini. Number 10, sophomore defenseman Joseph Seljuda. Number 11, sophomore forward Alec Garibet. Number 12, senior defense Adam Burchin. 13, senior forward Stephen Heppensteel. Number 14 is sophomore forward Seth McKenna. Number 15, sophomore forward Brendan Ma. Number 16 is senior forward Paul Kratzios. Number 17, sophomore forward Liam Anastasia. Number 18 is sophomore forward Zander Soya. Number 19, senior defenseman Mitchell Schulman. Number 20, sophomore forward Henry Kong. Number 21, freshman forward Nicholas Katarja. 22, senior forward and the captain Nicholas Spinelli. Number 23, freshman defense Nicholas Musich. Number 24, senior forward Nicholas Heffley. Number 25, freshman defenseman Thomas Hall. Number 26 is sophomore defenseman Stephen Feldman. Number 27, junior forward Ryan Garrett. Number 30, sophomore goaltender Henry Badcock.
For the love of the game, the team, or for two, Recovery Sports Grill. At Recovery Sports Grill, you'll always have courtside seats to exciting live sports coverage. And for outstanding loyalty perks, join our Hall of Fame, Recovery Sports Grill, serving up smiles every season.
Are boundary pushing change agents. We do what it takes to make things happen together. It's our collaborative spirit that sparks creativity and pushes us to think beyond ourselves. We're scrappy and unabashedly enthusiastic about our passions and projects. We are hardwired for the havoc of change. We know it isn't easy, that theories can fail and world changing can feel futile. But that's the calm before the brilliant storm. The breath you take before you break through. Small change comes from asking why. Changing the world comes from asking, why not? That's the question we ask everyone, from freshmen to faculty. It's the question that fuels us to find the next new. The question we ask you, why not change the world?
I'm Andy James at Rental Honda, and this is my buddy Bo. Looking to sell your car or truck? We want to buy it. Are you looking for a great used car? We have a huge selection. That's why Rental Honda has been your Honda dealer for 44 years.
Hey, It's the most historic conference in college hockey. It's a battle night in and night out. ECAC hockey, an iconic conference home to 12 of the most prestigious universities and programs in the world, and showcasing the best student athletes in the sport. Top-notch facilities and arenas, incomparable traditions, passionate fans, alumni who go on to become elite professionals, leaders, and champions. ECAC hockey, there's no experience like it.
The team, 4 for 2, recovery sports group. At recovery sports world. We always have quick, sexy to exciting live sports coverage. And if you want stadium quality, you can restore our whole thing to recover sports world. So we have smiles every season.
Second period about to begin from the Houston Fieldhouse on the campus of RPI. We're back here on RPI TV. It is Engineers Hockey, and after one period of play, it was all RPI in the opening 20 minutes as three goals from the home team, Max Malinsky, Brad McNeil, CJ Ragula, all within the span of 5 minutes and 57 seconds that shot the Engineers out to a 1-0, 2-0, and now 3-0 lead. We're ready to go for the second period of action alongside Dan Fridgen. I'm Dan Ball. Thanks so much for joining us here on this Sunday afternoon in the Capital Region on a, well, much nicer day today than it was yesterday, 24 hours ago. The Engineers win the draw and send the puck in deep. There is a conversation that Dan Fridgen and I were having just before we went on the air that I think might be intriguing to dive a bit deeper into, but we'll save that for our next whistle, as meanwhile, it's controlled by Duncan Penman and cleared back out to center. Brendan Booty sends it through just out of the reach of John Beaton. Knocked to the middle. Brown has a wobbling puck go on and off of his tape, so it's sent in with conviction by Nick Ardanaz. RPI last season, a record of 14-20-1. They finished in a tie for seventh in ECAC hockey, got the seventh overall seed in the tournament. A home game in the win-or-go-home opening round of the ECAC hockey tournament. Taken the other way, 2-on-2 led by Biondi. That shot went wide. Hacked at by Jackson Camp, keeping the puck in deep. Biondi goes to the backhand, battling with Strom. He draws a penalty. Nick Strom will head to the box on a hold just over a minute into the second period, and we'll see the Griffins power play for the first time today.
Well, you mentioned Jackson Camp. Shout out to his dad, Sean, who's listening or watching, possibly back home in the Ottawa area. He was the former Griffins coach for, I think, the last 16 years.
Wow.
Very successful coach. And just retired this past season, which opened a door for Josh
RPI penalty
Dixon.
To number 23, Nick Strong.
Well, a hi and a hello to the entire family if they're watching here on RPI TV. Make sure, while you're watching, you click subscribe on the channel. You'll get non-hockey broadcasts through the remainder of the athletic year. And you'll also get great content, so make sure you do that. If you're a fan, an alum, or otherwise of the Engineers community, this is the spot to be. Kept in at the line by DeYoung. Pass goes across the offensive end. Snapped on goal by Allenson. He missed high and wide. The puck came out with a lot of steam, headed to that near blue line, jumped over the stick of DeYoung. Forced back in by DeSimone, but sent the rest of the way down as Agnew gets the clear and the Engineers get the change. So you were pondering. We'll see where this rush goes in a moment as it's picked up by DeYoung on the far point. Near point, DeGurse, he shoots. That one missed. Knocked in front of the goal again. Kick save made by Watson. Rebound cleared by Laurie Surdy and sent all the way down. Good couple of chances by the Griffins and they're second tour in the offensive end on the power play, but the Engineers netminder makes a couple of nice saves.
I'm thinking that the Griffins must have had some success in their first four games on the power play because Coach Dixon had mentioned that he'd like to see more offense from his team and how they're going to create opportunities, score some goals other than on the power play.
Dovar Tinling was able to clear. They did score on the power play. Their lone goal in the 2-1 loss against Nipissing was a power play goal. They ended up 1-for-4 in that game. It was a little difficult, admittedly, to unearth the other team-related statistics. Cleared, but knocked down by Liam Hamm as there were a couple of Engineers that were sitting right in the middle. Picked up at the top of the circles. Hamm wheels, shoots. That one got blocked, and it's cleared by Regula. Up at center and sent the rest of the way in by Winterton. John Beaton on the near side wall. Kept in by Hamm again. Liam Hamm, a couple of nice moves, winds and fires, and he missed the far side post. That one will ring its way all the way down onto the cage where it's handled by Brendan Cregan. Beaton in there creating some havoc, trying to force a turnover with Emmett Gordon. Nearly did that time with Biondi as it's picked up at the line and sent in by Amata. Kick save made by Cregan. Smolinski pokes it free for Beaton. John Beaton protects on his backhand but has it stolen away. Knocked through the neutral zone. Behind Biondi where Smolinski will pick up possession and send it in deep. Ian Ferguson backhands it along. Stolen by Brackett at the top of the circles. Jack Brackett has it poke checked away from him. Now a race for the puck in front of the Engineers bench. Scooped up by Wilson and sent in deep. Knocked to the far corner. Smolinski the first one there. Poked back out to the neutral zone. It's the defenseman Matta who was leading the breakout. Smolinski forces a pass to the middle. Scooped up by Payant who's hauled down. Decided to go one on a couple. That was the only option he had. Good hit laid on DeSimone there by Smolinski as he was cruising down the near side wall. Here come the Engineers, 3-on-2. Payant lost it, regains possession for the trailer. Brichette off his skate. He finds it, sent it toward Regula, but the puck was bouncing on its way through. Stolen away and scooped up by Podolski. Sharp angle shot, saved by Watson. and he will hang on. Just over 5 minutes gone by in the second period. Dan Fridgen, you were wondering aloud as to what some of the effects of Jack Watson's new equipment design may be.
Yeah, I was just thinking about, you know, we're way up here looking at it, but on ice level, if you're a shooter going in on Jack, whether it be a breakaway or just shooting on him, what kind of a visual effect that would have on the shooter?
You'd imagine, you know, it's nothing major, but we're talking about differences of split seconds here that can help a goalie make a save. So it's an interesting thought. It's different. You could give Watson that, and it's different from what he had as a sophomore. So we'll monitor that one accordingly. As
I've seen pads with different colors, different designs. I've never seen pads with patterns.
That one will go for icing. So the faceoff will come back in front of Watson and his pads with 13:54 to go in the second period. It's a bit of a defining year coming up for Jack Watson, as he'll be pushed for playing time by Carson Cherepak, the incoming sophomore. He had a .308 goals against average and an .895 save percentage in 30 games last year, but in 19 games the year before, a .239 goals against average and a .922 save percentage with a record of 9-9. So you're wondering which goaltender you'll get, as we'll see a penalty here with 13:44 to go. It will be a slashing call that will be assessed to the Griffins. We've seen both power plays once each so far in this one. We'll see RPI get a chance on the man advantage for the second time today.
Well, we've mentioned the OUA, and there's 10 teams in the West. There's 9 teams in the East, and one of those teams is Concordia University. And the goaltending coach for Concordia University happens to be the one and only Jim Corsi of the analytics where they picked up the Corsi.
The Corsi?
Yes.
Wow.
Yes. I found that very interesting.
A drive by Smolinski gets deflected on its way through, and it's shot past Ardenas and all the way down. That is very interesting. 71. I was never entirely sure, if I'm honest, if that phrase was an acronym or if it was a name, as Brichette tries to knife his way through. Cregan will hang on and take a face-off. The penalty, just to do some house cleaning, was on Hunter Brazier at the 6:16 mark. It was a slashing call, as we take a look at the chance from Brichette. Have you ever had any run-ins with Mr. Jim Corsi?
No, but I mentioned that to Coach Dave Smith before the game, and he said to give a shout-out to Jim Corsi because he knows him very well.
Ah.
But no, I was just doing some reading.
Smolinski shoots again. Knocked down in front of the cage. Ardenas picks it up at the top of the circles, goes lengthwise across the point. Brichette sends for Ardenas, who kept the zone not once but twice on a couple of nice plays. Smolinski tried to send it cross ice for Brichette. In the process, the engineers take a penalty. This one will be a hook, as Brichette was trying to catch that pass. Tyler Hotson, meanwhile, will be the guilty party, so that negates the power play that had a minute and 9 seconds remaining. We'll skate 4-on-4 for that minute and 9 instead, and then we'll see Guelph on their power play for the second time.
And of course, he's used in analytics, and it's an advanced statistic used in hockey to measure shot differential while a team is playing at even strength. And I'll let you know what that entails the next break.
You know, you never know what lanes of information you'll find as you prep for these broadcasts. You find things sometimes you just never think you would. So more on that in a moment, in a tease from my good friend and analyst Dan Fridgen. Meanwhile, the Griffins are regrouping in their own end. Hotson for a hook at 7:03. So RPI now 0 for 2 on their power play. Guelph will get a shot on it in now 35 seconds. A lot of speed. Here comes Regula around the cage, centering pass. Nobody there as Beaton was step for step with him the entire way. Meanwhile, it's Beaton in the near corner, trying to send a pass cross point to Lori Surdy. It got blocked, so RPI will regroup in the neutral zone. Both teams taking chances to build up a bit of speed and attack in the offensive zone here on the 4-on-4. Surdy, a nice move, wasn't able to knock it through the defender's legs on the second attempt. The hammering of the twig from Jack Watson, meaning that the penalty is over. Brazier back on the ice. He stays out on the ice for this power play that will now have 40 seconds remaining on it. Second opportunity for Guelph here today. As Dan Fridgen mentioned, a power play heavy team in terms of their offense so far this season. Knocked to the line, but kept in on the play from Nolan Forster. But on second attempt, it's knocked back out to the neutral zone. That's where it's picked up by Camp and sent in deep. Puck takes a bizarre bounce off of the end glass, off of one of the stanchions in the corner, right around where the Zamboni door is here at the Houston Fieldhouse. The engineers do successfully clear the zone. One last rush on the power play for the Griffins as spinning away is Camp. They'll send it low of the goal for Forster. Out of the box is Hotsit. Pass goes back to the point. We're back to 5-on-5 with 10:45 to go. That's where Jack Watson will find the puck and hang on for a faceoff with now 10:44 to go in the second. And the sequel to the Corsi conversation, well, that's what we find right now.
Well, Coach Smith uses this analytics measurement, and it's the shots on goal plus the missed shots on goal plus the blocked shot attempts toward the opposition's net, and you subtract that from the same shot attempts directed at your own team's net.
Okay, pencils down. I hope everybody got that one. So it is a, to try to condense it, and I'm pretty, so it's a way to measure, it's a way to kind of measure possession and how efficient you are in possession. Is that roughly
yes.
what you're explaining?
Yep.
Knocked corner to corner. Very interesting. Puck sits in the crease for a moment. Brichette battling. Able to lose a defender. Finds Lori Surdy. He'll shoot. Kick save made by Cregan. You know, it brings up the ever-changing landscape, not just in hockey. This is in any sport that you'll find. And trying to find that right balance between the eye test and the scouting that has been done for a while and the analytics and how to apply both in a way that helps you build a successful team and a successful roster. And you know, as you add that the third assistant coach onto the staff for these Division I teams, I can imagine it really helps to kind of continue to develop both sides of that, the scouting as well as the analytics.
Yeah, no question. And you know, it's one thing to collect the information. It's another thing to apply that information to individuals and the team.
And that's something that, you know, you have to have the right people in terms of staffing, and it also doesn't happen overnight either. Meanwhile, here comes Brackett, an inside-out move to gain some room. Here is Brackett shooting, saved by Cregan, rebound still loose. Couple of whacks at it as Payant was there with Brazier, but Brazier is able to clear.
I don't think Brackett got all that shot that he wanted to.
Along the far side boards, it hops over the stick of John Evans. Now a 2-on-1 the other way, led by Biondi, backdoor feed, a shot by DeSimone, save, rebound loose in front, Watson sprawling down, the puck cleared to the far boards. Well, a quick flurry for Guelph as they maintain possession. Allinson fakes the one-timer. That's Nathan Allinson, the second-year defender out of Waterloo, Ontario, was playing catch with Liam Hamm on defense. RPI on their breakout as Payant was surveying his options. Gets the shot in on Cregan. Brown battling with Hamm for possession. The two still tussling as Booty went in to try to help. Gio Biondi is able to clear, knocked down by Nick Strom with the glove. Booty was able to just stay on side by a hair and send a pass in front that got deflected before it got to the net. Beaton around the top of the circles. It is John Beaton. Will hit the brakes and try the other way. Beaton, a backhand pass. Here is Strom. He shoots and a blocker save made. Nice stop by Cregan. Collected at the point by Smolinski. Backdoor feed was looking for John Beaton. It got deflected on its way to him. Beaton, his stick down, was looking to deflect it on the backhand. But it's stolen away by the Griffins and cleared back out to center. Smolinski in a battle for the puck, as was McNeil. Scooped up by Penman, sent on goal from the far side. That one's turned away as Allinson got the chance. Penman from the point, a drive and a save. Rebound still loose, swept wide on the chance from DeGuerce. Nolan DeGuerce in possession again, sends low for Biondi, who lays a big hit. The other way comes RPI, a 3-on-1 with a couple of trailers, now a 2-on-1. Ciccarello! And a save made by Cregan, a penalty upcoming. It'll be a slash, no penalty shot as we saw here yesterday at the Houston Fieldhouse, but RPI will go to the power play for the third time today, and they'll do it when we return. 7:16 to go, second period here in Troy. 3-0 RPI leading the University of Guelph Griffins. More after this, you're watching Engineers Hockey here on RPI TV. Troy Engineers going to the power play for the third time here today. A couple of changes to note. Carson Cherepak in the net for the Engineers now to our left. Cherepak started the game yesterday against Union. Did not allow a goal in that one as RPI had a 1-0 lead after the first 20 minutes of play. Also, Sutter Mazzotti, Austin Heidemann, Jake Gagneau are now on the bench and ready to play the second half of this one. As again, in exhibition games, you can dress your whole roster. A lot of times you'll see teams kind of rotate lines between periods. So Mazzotti and Heidemann onto the ice and already on for a power play as Tinling's pass blocked. Heidemann whiffs on his shot. Now Tinling, backhand pass out of the reach of Brichette, and it will roll its way back into the neutral zone.
Well, he had the right idea. He had Brichette on the back door. He just put the pass too far away from him.
Knocked ahead of Smolinski, so Guelph is able to clear. The penalty was on Duncan Penman, a slash at the 12:44 mark, so third power play for RPI. They are 0-for-2. 0-for-5 so far this weekend as Heidemann sends in. Sharp angle shot, save made. Knocked back at the neutral zone and a diving play made by Mazzotti to disrupt what could have been a shorthanded chance.
Well, that guy looked like he was shot out of a barrel.
Brichette, a nice inside-out move, leaving for the trailing Tinling, and that one whistles just wide. Scooped up by Brichette on the near side, top of the circles. Smolinski will slow things down. Austin Heidemann back for Smolinski. Brichette, top of the circles. Saucer feed trying to go across the offensive end for Heidemann. Now it's Smolinski back for Heidemann. He'll shoot off the post. Heidemann had a lot of steam behind that shot as Guelph will clear, but only out to the neutral zone after the clearing attempt was knocked down
by the official.
Here comes Sullivan. He'll go on a tour of the offensive end as his team in the midst of a line change quickly across for Gagneau. So all offensive players that just checked into the game here halfway through are getting a spin on the power play. Sent through the crease, no deflection there from, or slot I should say, no deflection from Sullivan. 3 seconds and two remaining on the penalty against Penman. A deflection in the slot from Sullivan goes up and above the net. The penalty has come to an end right as that puck was going out of play, so Penman out of the box. An 0-for-3 mark for RPI on their power play so far today.
Well, good pressure by RPI, moving the puck around. Just missed on that redeflection by Sullivan. Some of the opportunities have been going wide.
Face off to the left of Brendan Cregan in the offensive end for the Engineers. Brought in, left for the trailer, sent on goal, and a kick save made by Cherpak. A lot of speed there by Luke Kutkevicius, who is the one leading that rush. Knocked over the boards, over the glass, and into the stands on the defensive play from Laurie Surtees. So just under 5 minutes remaining here in the second period. A 3-0 advantage on first period goals from Max Smolinski, Brad McNeil, and CJ Regula. It was McNeil and Kutkevicius on the draw, won by McNeil. Engineers gain the line. That is Danny Ciccarello. Ciccarello will wheel on his backhand, trying to fight for a bit of room. Now he'll use his defenders. Ardanaz will shoot through a screen. Save made by Cregan. Rebound was sprayed into the far corner. Picked up by Nathan Sullivan. The calls of Sully as it's scooped up at the point by Ardanaz. Ardanaz activates right along the goal line. Sullivan, as Regula was opening up for a one-timer. Ardanaz top of the circles. He scores! Nick Ardanaz from the top of the circles off his back foot. He fires it home, and the Engineers are up 4-0 here at home.
Well, the third goal by an RPI defenseman today. Ardanaz, and they had some real good puck possession here before they score this goal. And a real nice play by Sullivan, Ardanaz, giving the puck to each other, and a nice snapshot from just in the slot area.
Well, Nick Ardanaz, the sophomore out of Surrey, British Columbia. Here comes Heidemann. Looks for the trailer. They score! Brendan Booty up and over the blocker.
Well,
Heidemann, two goals in 8 seconds. Good Lord.
Sorry. And Heidemann just comes into the game and gets a helper.
Efficiency at its finest. We'll take another look at Brendan Booty up and above the blocker. Nice shot.
Yeah, this goaltender tends to go down in his butterfly pretty early, so he's got to be active up top, which he missed that one cleanly.
Well, just as you were finishing the description of goal four, the Engineers have goal five. They went a full period in time and then some, roughly 24 minutes between goal three and goal four. And then two goals in 8 seconds. So Ardanaz, the sophomore out of Surrey, British Columbia. Then it was Brendan Booty, the graduate student out of Langley, British Columbia, transfer from a season ago out of the University of North Dakota, scoring in rapid succession. And you're right about Heidemann. He was, it looked like he had a chance to shoot. He found the trailer of Booty instead. A couple of nice shots in rapid succession from RPI, who hold a 5-0 lead. Brichette through the neutral zone. He was knocked away in his pursuit of the puck by Jackson Camp. Scooped up by Tinling, his pass towards Gagneau got blocked, so Brichette will wheel back into his own end. Always a good sign when your public address announcer has to differentiate between your one goal that you scored and another, in this case your fourth and your fifth. Brichette leaves for Gagneau, he shoots, and it's off the glove of Cregan, up and out of play.
5:49.
So Sullivan grabs the assist on Hartenhaus' goal.
Well, this is a very young Guelph team, that you could say.
And by number 7, Max Smolinski.
So Max Smolinski now with 2 points on his ledger here today.
Scored by 29 from 12.
RPI with possession in the offensive end here in the second period. Now up 5 as Evans had it, lost it. Payant's pass got blocked. Mata is able to keep it in with his skate. Brackett on second attempt has it knocked away from him. So Smolinski, McNeil, Ragula, Ardenaz, and Booty joining yesterday's goal scorers of Brown and Nikanen. No repeats for the Engineers on offense. 7 goals between 2 games as that one's knocked in front of the goal for a chance from Emmett Gordon that was steered away. We haven't seen Jake Lee this weekend. Really the only player that was not dressed at any point, one of last year's leading scorers with 22 points tied for the team lead with Ryan Mashey and Sutter Mazzotti, finished 2nd in both goals and assists. A very important player on this roster last year, so the offense clicking despite his absence. 2 minutes to go, 2nd period, 5-0 RPI. Ardenaz's pass got knocked down. Ragula is able to step away. Here's Nathan Sullivan on the near side. Sullivan trying to spin away from the pressuring defender Duncan Penman. Ciccarello shoots, that one got blocked. Sullivan finds the rebound. He'll wheel at the top of the zone, feeling pressure from Ferguson, kept in. Ragula, a nice move. Here is Ragula in front, deflected in on Cregan, who makes the save. A penalty coming up as players from both sides crash in front of the cage. We'll sort out the dirty laundry. It appears as though RPI will be going back to the power play.
Somewhat surprised that unless they want to do it at the end of the period with only 1:25 left and Cregan's still in there.
So the penalty, a hold. Ian Ferguson, the guilty party. One timer off the side of the goal from Mazzotti. Smolinski, he'll shoot through a screen, blockered away by Cregan. Smolinski again, that pass too far in front of him. The feed was coming from Brichette.
He receives 2 minutes for holding. Timeout penalty, 18 minutes, 35 seconds. Final minute of play in the period, last minute of play.
Brichette through the neutral zone. Top of the circle, Mazzotti, he'll hit the brakes. Mazzotti again at the hash marks, has it stolen away from him, kept in, no. On second attempt, it's cleared. Knocked around Smolinski on the play from Griffin Wilson. Brichette right at the blue line, had it knocked away from him, and the Griffins are able to clear with now under 30 seconds to go in the second.
Yeah, Mazzotti should have went down low with that. He's trying to force that pass into the middle of the ice, and the Griffins do a good job of breaking that up.
Pass goes behind Dovar Tinling, so he will have to regroup. Brichette at the end of his shift. An inside-out move, leaving for the trailing Mazzotti. Knocked back to the line, Smolinski gone. Yo, save by Cregan. Rebound high up in the air, gloved down by Brazier as the clock will hit triple zeros. Here on the scoreboard at the Houston Fieldhouse, A scoreboard that has been lit up, metaphorically speaking, with goals from the home team. Through the first 40 minutes of play, they scored 3 in the first period. They tack on 2 more in the second period with goals from Nick Ardenas and Brendan Booney, 8 seconds apart, as we take a look at the replay from the second period.
Well, there's a goal here. Just no traffic, really. Again, he's going down early, and it's butterflying. It's just getting up over top of him. There's another one. Same thing. Down early, over his shoulder. Usually when you're a butterfly goaltender, when you go down to the butterfly, it's a timing thing to make sure that if they are going to go high, it's going to catch you in the shoulder.
Well, the timing not right on both of those shots from the engineers. You could tell the directive on that one was shoot high. They did, and Nick Ardenas and Brendan Booty made it 4-5-0 respectively. That's where we stand after 2 periods of play. We'll step aside here on RPI TV and be back with third period action in just a few moments as the engineers wrap up their opening exhibition weekend here at home. 5-0 RPI over Guelph. Back with more after this. You're watching Engineers Hockey on RPI TV.
Thank you.
We'll add to that a little bit to bring up the date. The 3-0 and 3 undefeated at the RPI possibly.
Hey fans, I'm Matt Watson. Welcome to Skate with the Engineers. Don't forget to grab your skates on Section 2 following the game, and we'll see you on the ice.
Periods down and one to go here at the Houston Fieldhouse on the campus of RPI. We're back On RPI TV, it is Engineers Hockey after 40 minutes of play in the second half of a back-to-back season-opening weekend of exhibition games. It's been all Engineers here this afternoon. 3 goals in the first, 2 goals in the second, and a 5-0 advantage through the first 2 periods of play. Alongside Dan Fridgen, Dan Ball with you here this afternoon. Thanks so much for joining us. And Dan Fridgen, not a whole lot to dislike about the effort from the Engineers here on this Sunday.
No, they've got it rolling. I mean, they're playing well defensively. Watson is now out, and you have Chirapak in the pipes, and Guelph is going to come out here and try to make this into a game here in the third period.
An inauspicious way to start, as Guelph will have to kill off the rest of the penalty that was assessed at the 18:35 mark of the second to Ian Ferguson. The announcement coming over the loudspeaker that Carson Chirapak is in the game.
So you see number 71 out there for Guelph on the penalty kill, Hunter Brazier.
Sure.
I've noticed him. He was supposed to go to RIT the year of COVID, but something happened there, and he's ended up at the University of Guelph.
Amazing how things can change. He has certainly been around the puck. You know that you can definitely notice his speed when he's out on the ice. And you know, the note about the younger group here is an interesting one, and this is this group that's dressed here today are the elder statesmen, as you have I think by my count four first year players on this roster that are not dressed for today's game for one reason or another. Left for Booty, he'll walk in front, Heidemann! And it deflected up and out of play. Sounded like there might have been a little iron on its way out of play, but the engineer is nearly completing the touchdown on the pass from Booty to Heidemann.
Well, I don't know if the goaltender Cregan got a piece of that or not. Let's see from this angle. Oh yeah, blocker. You know, he has been pretty good with that blocker, but a couple of have eluded him and ended up on the scoreboard.
Here is Gagneau in front, saved by Cregan as Gagneau was disrupted for just enough time to allow Cregan to come out of his crease and cut down the angle to make that save. A couple of good chances for RPI in the early going.
Yes, right off the faceoff too, so RPI has been doing a real good job. I don't have the statistics, but looks like they've been winning their fair share of the faceoffs.
We have not been privileged, unfortunately, to the normal live statistics, which you can find on rpiathletics.com for every other regular season game. Gagneau will send it through the legs of the defender after his shot got blocked. Sent in front of the goal, batted away as Forster was going to have a whack at it. Nice play on the defensive end. Sent from the point from Allinson into the catching glove of Chirapak. He'll hang on and take a faceoff with just over a minute and a half gone by. A quick look at the out-of-town scoreboard. First from yesterday on the men's side, it was St. Lawrence beating RIT 4-3. Clarkson over Notre Dame 3-1. Quinnipiac Bobcats on banner night fell in overtime to Boston College in Hampden by a score of 2-1. Elsewhere, Colgate fell to UConn, which is a Hockey East hopeful heading into this season, as this one sent wobbling end over end to the defensive end. Liam Hamm battling for possession, making sure there weren't any that was missed in what was a big Saturday of non-conference action. A couple of exhibitions, one of which we saw right here. This one will head all the way down. Chirapak will slow it down. Always fun to see the non-conference matchups. From a Northeast perspective, I always do like to see the ECAC and Hockey East matchups, which is why I was happy to see the stretch of games that RPI goes on coming up next. They get 2 games in Maine next weekend, then the following weekend a game in Boston College and in Providence, as we'll have a stoppage of play, a penalty, and a trip. With now 17:32 to go here in the third, and it'll be the freshman Brad McNeil who will head to the box on the tripping call.
Yeah, you're right about, you know, Coach Dixon mentioning that they have a really young team. Here's another look at the trip in here somewhere. But, you know, that I think that's more young from a first-year perspective as opposed to an age perspective. And I looked on the website. I couldn't find anywhere where it listed what year their birth year they were born.
I can tell you, without noting it for every single player on the roster, it was a lot of what you would expect in overagers, where you'd get anywhere between 21 years old to 25 years old on the roster, just with guys having played, as we mentioned earlier on, considerable time in the junior ranks. So you're right, it's young from a U sports perspective, but a lot of competitive hockey played by a lot of the guys on this roster. Brackett trying to clear, Surdy on second attempt will, forcing Tristan DeYoung back to regroup in his own ends. So those are games 1, 2, 3, and 4 for RPI on their regular season opening 5-game road trip. They'll then open conference play against Union, and on the back door they score. The shutout comes to an end just under 3.5 minutes into the third period. Guelph on the board on the power play as we take a look.
Well, this kind of ricocheted off of one of the defenders who was going down to block the shot, and that went right to the goal scorer, Jonah DeSimone, for the University of Guelph.
Well, a nice bounce, but the Griffins and DeSimone will take it. Ironically enough, after your conversation with Coach Dixon, it does end up being a power play goal that gets the Griffins on the board. Near side, Forster, save made by Cherpak as he shot it from the near post. Jonah DeSimone, the first year out of Richmond Hill, Ontario. A whistle and a stoppage. DeSimone spent last year with the Markham Royals of the OJHL. 17 points in 33 games. For which he spent 4 years and 112 total games in the OHL, all with the Niagara Ice Dogs. Nathan Allison, Tristan DeYoung, two defenders with two assists on the goal from DeSimone. Did not record any stats to DeSimone in the OUA opener. Kept in at the line by Regula and knocked in deep. It was in the direction of Brendan Booty. Kept in at the line by Ardenaz, one of the five goal scorers, as Heidemann turns and wheels. That one got blocked. Knocked back out to the neutral zone and through the wickets of Regula, and Cherpak will decide I've seen enough of this and hang on for a faceoff with 15:42 to go here in the third.
Puck drops at 7 p.m. so stop by the box office at Hicks Fieldhouse today and order your tickets.
One other note from the out-of-town scoreboard from yesterday: a victory on the road for Brian Vines and the RPI women's hockey team as that shot gets deflected and misses the net. A 3-1 victory in regulation over Bemidji State. So they go 1-0-1 on their weekend and have opened the season at 3-0-3 in non-conference play. This one will roll end over end and be icing against the Engineers. So a congratulations to that group. Morgan Skoda, Naya Phillip, Isabel Hardy scoring for the Engineers, so we'll be back home here at the Houston Fieldhouse this coming Friday evening for a 6 o'clock puck drop against Syracuse. Face off to the right of Cherpak. There goes McNeil busting his way through. He's able to knock that one back out to the neutral zone, and then a collision and a penalty upcoming as Sullivan rode Ian Ferguson into the boards right in front of the Griffins bench, and now some pushing and shoving on both sides. Ciccarello has his left hand up in the face of one of the Griffins players. Here's another look.
Yeah, it looked like it. I don't know if that was caused by him, but anyways, he's going to sit for 2 minutes or less. boarding. I guess it was the hit after he went down, the Griffin defenseman.
RPI penalty.
So Sullivan will sit for, as Dan Fritcher put it, 2 minutes or less. I like that one. Boarding the call, 4:45. The time as a shot turned aside by Chairpack. Kick save made on the shot from Nathan Allenson. Brackett sweeps it out and into the neutral zone. As DeSimone will slow things down. Check that, DeYoung will slow things down. Kept in at the line, no, on second attempt. It was rolled that DeYoung did not after the zone was gained by Kutkevicius. Swept along by Agnew, scooped up by Piant. He'll knock it back out to center now with 45 seconds gone by in the penalty.
Good pressure by RPI penalty killers. Griffins are having a tough time setting this up. And here they come.
The penalty kill for RPI, as that one's taken away by Brendan Booty. Booty with the step will knock it into the near corner. Gets dumped down, now goes in the near corner for a battle with Liam Hamm. Griffins pull it away and break out. The penalty kill for RPI had been clean so far this weekend. They're now 2-for-3 on their penalty kill and 4-for-5 on the weekend. Sent to the line, Camp gets it moving. He'll pick it up back in the near point. Sent to the corner, it was knocked off the stick of Winterton. A physical battle at the line and a nice play made there by Regula, and then more shoving in front of the Griffins bench that's gonna get Regula a penalty. After those two battled to try to either keep the puck in or not, we'll have a whistle and a stoppage and a rough that will go against Regula for that exchange right by the blue line. So the penalty kill, McNeil had exited the box, so the engineers will go right back on the penalty kill just moments after they went back to 5-on-5.
I'm kind of laughing because Regula did not give an inch on that exchange whatsoever.
So the time of the penalty, 6:45. So that was as Brad McNeil was coming out of the bench is when the whistle, or coming out of the penalty box is when the whistle blew. Allenson shoots through a screen, save Chairpack, rebound picked up by Mazzotti and cleared to the line and over the line. So a whistle for an offside. No, that's an interesting one and a good point made by you, where. Now, what I don't know is, can you fight at the U Sports level?
I don't believe so.
Okay. Because you can at the junior level where these guys have played in the past.
Yeah, but I know that even the Canadian Hockey League is cracking down on fighting, where if you do fight, you get thrown out of that game and possibly a game misconduct for the next game.
Okay. Very interesting there.
I read that somewhere, and I don't know whether it was instituted this year.
What a move, and a chance in front for Kutkevicius. That one over the top of the crossbar. Luke Kutkevicius, a very nice move to get by the engineer's defense as Guelph, after their power play goal, gaining some steam, but Tindling is able to steal it away and clear the rest of the way down.
Tell you what, you don't want to be puck watching when that guy's coming down on you one-on-one.
Just under a minute gone by in the second consecutive penalty taken by RPI as Camp will force it into the corner. Luke Kutkevicius, one of the veterans on this roster, fifth year, fourth season for the Griffins. Out of Toronto, Ontario, played for Quebec, the Remparts in the QMJHL. Seared away by Cregan and scooped up low by Gio Biondi. Near point, it is Camp. Biondi, a backhander. Nice play with the skate to keep that in. 20 seconds now are just about to go on the penalty against Regula, stolen by Gagneau and sent the rest of the way down.
Good play by RPI to keep that stick on the ice, take away those passing lanes, and sooner or later, Guelph gives it to them.
Stick taps coming from the netminder Cregan, letting his teammates know the penalty is over. So after ceding a power play goal a few moments ago, RPI goes 2 for 2 in consecutive penalty kills over a 4-minute span as the puck goes out of play. A whistle and a stoppage with 11:01 to go here in the third, and RPI in the lead by a score of 5-1. Luke Kutkevicius was one of a handful of players, being that he is in his fifth year. That was part of the 2019-20 Griffin squad that did win an OUA championship in U Sports. Since that time, the program has taken a step back, at least from championship standards, but we've discussed that throughout the broadcast. So championship level play in very recent memory for this group, with players on the roster who have won titles, as Brackett starts the break in. McNeil collects on the backhand. Sent to the line for Agnew, who tried to make a move at the line but was unsuccessful. The other way come the Griffins, and a hit laid by Mata. Saucer pass for the trailer, deflected in front, saved by Cherepak on the chance from DeSimone. And the puck is knocked in the near corner.
Agnew got bailed out there by Cherepak.
More pleasantries being exchanged behind the play. This time it was Nolan DeGerse with Lucas Mata. So the two transfers on defense for the Engineers, the two who have been the most active in that regard, as the puck is deflected up and out of play. With 10:02 to go here in the third of what is going to prove to be an interesting end to the weekend between these two teams.
And that OUA championship is known as the Queen's Cup. That's why I'd asked you earlier what the ECAC championship is, the Whitelaw Cup, and this the OUA championship is the Queen's Cup.
Heidemann tried to make the breakout pass as Mazzotti had found some room behind the defense. Smolinski starts the breakout off the skate of Mazzotti, knocked along by Heidemann. Queen's Cup for this Guelph team in 2015 as well as 2020 in the OUA ranks. They were in another conference that had another A attached to the acronym back in the 70s, 80s, and 90s. A couple cups there as well, as Regula goes to his backhand, sends it off the side of the goal.
And the last two championships of the Queen's Cup has been won by UQTR, the University of Quebec at Trois-Rivières.
Very nice, with a little bit of an accent added, just to prove the point. 9 minutes exactly to go, third period here in Troy, 5-1 RPI over Guelph. We'll take a break and be back with more after this. You're watching Engineers Hockey on RPI TV.
Remember, please enter the ice via the visiting bench.
It's the most historic conference in college hockey. It's a battle night in and night out. ECAC hockey, an iconic conference home for 12 of the most prestigious universities and programs in the world, and showcasing the best student athletes in the sport. Top-notch facilities and arenas, incomparable traditions, passionate fans, alumni who go on to become elite professionals, leaders, and champions. ECAC hockey, there's no experience like it.
9 minutes to go, third period here at the Houston Fieldhouse. 5-1 RPI over Guelph in a Sunday matinee exhibition style here in Troy. Face-off won cleanly by Tinling. Brochette picks it up on the far wall. Centers a pass in front. Tinling, save made by Cregan. Rebound loose for Gagneau. That one whacked in front of the goal, but it's pulled free and taken out of harm's way by Ashton Reeser. Regula goes through the neutral zone, knocked along by Gagneau. Tinling heads in against the lanky 6'4" Ashton Reeser, a second-year defender out of Stouffville, Ontario. Tinling tried to backhand it in front, absorbs the hit from the aforementioned Reeser, who will send it corner to corner for Jacob Winterton, knocked down by Gagneau, but on second attempt, he's able to clear the line and step in. Here is Winterton in front of the goal, and he kind of got caught between shot and pass. Guelph maintains possession. Ferguson goes point to point, looking for a deflection in front, didn't get one. Now a battle in the near corner. Two aside, they will scrap for possession of the puck. Now reinforcements coming from both sides. Neither side giving an inch. Eventually it's pulled free. Brad McNeil was the one in there creating the problems as Brochette will send it off the far side wall and in deep, and RPI will go for a change. Taken in over the line, and a hit was laid and a penalty upcoming. That's going to go against Smolinski, as Hunter Brazier was coming in with speed. Smolinski had interfered with him, and then there was a collision between he and Nick Strom at the end boards. Right at the end of that replay, that is the look at the penalty upcoming to RPI.
Oh, yeah, it looked like Strom kind of lost an edge there. A little close to the boards, always a dangerous situation, but he's up and okay.
.12:37, time of the penalty on Max Smolinski. It is an interference call.
RPI penalty to number 7, Max.
RPI has taken four consecutive penalties, and Guelph will go on to their sixth power play of the afternoon. A little difficult to work on 5-on-5 scoring when you're on the power play this often, as Allinson goes cross ice. They score! Nolan DeGerse on the one-timer from the far side, and a nice pass from Nathan Allinson, his second assist on the power play here in the third. And the goal from DeGerse makes it a 5-2 game.
Well, that was just a great setup. Started at the point with DeJong, and then over to Allison, and of course he finds DeGerse on the backside. DeGerse didn't even stop that puck. He just shot it right off the one-timer. Cherepak, not a chance to stop that puck.
So two power play goals here in the third, making it now a three-goal game. Knocked back out to the neutral zone. Booty tried to keep it moving. A wobbling puck is settled by Lucas Matta. Booty goes lengthwise. Mazzotti curls, drags, and shoots. That one got blocked. Sent to the line. One timer from Matta, and a save made by Cregan. Lucas Matta got a lot on that one-time shot as he was backing towards the Guelph bench. Got the shot away, and Cregan made the save. Nolan DeGerse, the second year out of Brights Grove, Ontario, gets the goal. Allinson and DeJong both with assists on now both power play goals, as Tristan DeJong will get the secondary assist on that one. The two defenders who are the quarterbacks on this power play unit. That'll be a whistle and a stoppage for a hand pass as Payant tried to just scoop it towards John Evans for a shot. But a whistle and a face-off in the neutral zone with now 6:30 to go here in the third.
Payant showing some handball skills there. Picking that puck out of the air and scooping it up.
Puck is knocked up and into the Guelph bench. So Payant had the primary assist on the game-opening goal yesterday, the goal from Finn Brown. He was credited with the primary assist on the opening goal here today as well, the goal from Max Malinsky. Payant, the freshman out of Hawkesbury, Ontario. So an exciting opening weekend for him. Worth noting that freshman Nathan Sullivan out of Calgary, Alberta, has two assists on his ledger in his many games this weekend as well. Ciccarello pulls it free to the point. It is Matta shooting through a screen, deflected and a save. Penalty upcoming against the Griffins as Ciccarello is spilled down. Battle in the near corner. Matta will step in and pull it free. Lucas Matta shoots. That one's blocked. Serdi went for the stick lift. Couldn't get the puck or the stick. It's knocked down by Hunter Brazier. So after a string of penalties against the Engineers, it will be the Griffins who head to the box. The penalty coming against Duncan Penman, his second of the day, and RPI to the power play for the fifth time today.
Yeah, he was in an exchange there with McNeil. Kind of surprised one went and not both.
So it's Penman for a rough at 14:04. Smolinski walks the line. Here is Brochette shooting and a glove save made by Cregan. Rebound was loose for the moment. He's got it now. And will hang on for a whistle. As the faceoff will come back to his right as we take a look at that chance on the shot from Brochette.
He almost, well, yeah, that was loose. Throws it to the ice.
Knocked to the line and back out to center. Pretty much every time the Engineers go to the power play, it is Max Malinsky, the sophomore defenseman, who quarterbacks whatever the first unit would be. A nod toward things to come for the Engineers this season as another sophomore, that is Sutter Mazzotti. Mazzotti near side boards. Up for Smolinski, left for Mazzotti at the top of the circle, nearly left it behind him. Found it on second attempt, but his pass got blocked. And the Griffins will clear the rest of the way down. Smolinski will get it moving again. Lengthwise for Nathan Sullivan. Sullivan, with a couple of players in front of him, is able to get it low. Evans bunts it along for Laurie Serdi. Back for Regula. Serdi again, top of the circles, now low for Gagneau. Jake Gagneau this way for Serdi, who walks the line. Gagneau corrals. Centering pass in front, Sullivan, save made by Cregan, and it is cleared. A nice save made on a one-time attempt in front by Brendan Cregan.
That was a real good chance there by RPI. Boy, Cregan's gotten stronger here as the game has gone on after giving up five.
10 seconds remaining on the penalty as Sullivan keeps possession. Serdi in front for Sullivan. The pass did not connect. 3 seconds and two. Penman out of the box, wheeling and shooting off the glove on the shot from Gagneau. Pass attempt got blocked. Gagneau scoops it up on the near side wall. Gagneau battling for possession with Reeser. So the power play comes to an end. RPI 0 for 5 on their power play here today, as this one will roll its way back into the defensive end and be scooped up by Nick Ardenas with under 3.5 to go in regulation. The speedy Jack Brackett through the zone and shooting, save made, rebound loose in front of the goal. Still loose, and it's backhanded out in front of his own bench by Jonah DeSimone just in the nick of time.
Yeah, Cregan having a tough time grabbing the handle on that shot. Just left it out there for his defense to clear.
Like I did my part, now it's your turn as Ardenas keeps it moving quickly for Matta. Here is Ardenas working on a goal already today. Leaving for Ciccarello. Ciccarello sends it low, was looking for Payant. He had it for the moment, but lost it ultimately. A collision in that far corner as the physicality, I should say, is really ramped up in the third period as Payant keeps it moving. Here is Brackett shooting, and he missed the net just past that far side post. McNeil went for it all. He was able to knock the puck away, avoids another hit. We're in for an interesting final couple of moments here at the Houston Fieldhouse as Booty knocks it free. Rolling puck kept in and sent back toward the defensive unit. Scooped up by Liam Hamm. This Guelph team will stay in the Empire State for another game that's happening tomorrow. A 5 o'clock faceoff, a penalty coming up. No, rather it's an empty net, and that's a goal. Three straight goals from the Griffins here in the third period, just as Brendan Cregan was getting to the bench. A shot that goes over Carson Cherepak and into the back of the net. And just like that, it's a 5-3 game.
Well, they're certainly making it interesting here. I was watching the goaltender go to the net, but that's a top shelf beauty from the far side on Cherepak, who looked like he had overcommitted to the short side. First guy in line was Biondi, so we'll see if he picks up the tally.
Well, at the 18-11 mark, the goal is scored.
And I think RPI has called a timeout.
You know, I can't really blame them.
Timeout RPI.
It was all engineers in the first period, and really, for the most part, the second period as well. But the string of penalties that were assessed to RPI, 1, 2, 3, and then 4 yielded 2 power play goals. And that really allowed the momentum to kind of shift in this one, and that's why we see a game that is, in theory, competitive right now.
Well, I noticed in the second period, I was just thinking to myself that, you know, RPI is up 3-0, but it's like they took the pedal, they took their foot off the gas, and then all of a sudden they get 2 quick goals, and I'm like, okay, maybe they haven't taken their foot off the gas, but it's clear in this third period that they were just happy with the, you know, 5 goals that they've gotten, and you know, Guelph has come back here and made somewhat of a game of it.
You know, and you mentioned something yesterday that may be applicable today, how both teams, RPI and Union, look to be in pretty good shape after going through overtime and then a shootout. But now you're talking about 65 minutes worth of play yesterday and then a full game here today for the first time this weekend for RPI. So maybe you're seeing a little bit of fatigue in the back-to-back here in what is now technically period number 7. Not an excuse, just a thought on things as the net is empty once again. Cregan is on the bench. This one will roll down and be icing. With a minute and 28 to go. After the timeout, you could see on the screen here on RPI TV, Dave Smith had the whiteboard out and was game planning. And now with 1:28 remaining, it looks as though we'll see a timeout on the other side. And that's exactly the case.
Well, they'll be drawing up a face-off play, which they can only execute if they win the face-off.
So when you're having these conversations on the whiteboard, is it a win scenario and then a loss scenario that you're explaining in what is probably about a minute's time?
Yeah, I mean, if it's a loss scenario, you got to go real hard on the puck and make sure that, you know, first guy's taking the body, second guy's got to come in and take the puck as far as the puck support is concerned. So, yeah, that, you know, on a loss, you go right into the forecheck. But, you know, since it's on the left-hand side here, this defenseman that's going to be in the middle of the ice, should they lose the draw, is going to have to go over to the wall because you know RPI is going to try to hammer it around the boards, which is one of the comments that Coach made before the game, Coach Dixon. He said, you know, we were just noticing your glass is really, really high, the glass of the Houston Fieldhouse. And I think it's because some of the rinks they play in, the glass is lower. And I just told him that that was just the game plan of RPI. They like to ring the puck around the boards a lot.
There you go. This time around, it is Smolinski who clears the zone, not off the glass, but just flipping it up in the air. Strong play as the net remains empty with a minute 15 to go. The puck eludes DeGuerce. Sent back to the line with on goal by DeYoung. It missed high and wide. Puck bounces to the near corner, sent along the end boards. Kept in at the line on a nice play by Tristan DeYoung, but on second attempt at Smolinski, a rolling, wobbling puck that will go into the goal. They score! Just how you draw it up for the Engineers. The clear from Smolinski. It looked like it may have got tipped on its way through. We'll see either way. But a bit of breathing room with 51 seconds to go in the third.
Yeah, I don't know if it got tipped or not. It was a nice shot. It had just the right spin on it not to go wide. And just into the left side of the net.
Well, either way, assuming the goal stands as observed would be the best way. It looks like Max Smolinski might get the bookending goals in this one as the pass was out of the reach of McNeil. That one will go for icing. Just under 45 seconds to go in the third, and now 6-3. So after both teams took timeouts, the Engineers were able to clear the zone, and after second attempt were able to clear all the way down and in to extend the lead back up to 3. And what should prove to be the first regulation victory, though exhibition, of the season. Scooped up off the draw by Podolski. Podolski centers in front, they score! Believe that will belong to Zev Podolski, whose pass in front clanked off of Cherepak and went behind him. So it is now 6-4, the lead back down to 2 as we take a look at a interesting play in front.
Well, it went off the skate of the defender there. I think that's Ague. Jack. That's Pagola. Regula, sorry. Pagola, I'm thinking of the Buffalo owner.
Terry and Kim Pagula. Close. One letter away. No relation either way. So the goal will go to Podolski with an unofficial assist to the skate of CJ Regula. So Smolinski unassisted at 1909 with goal number 9 between the two teams. And now, just to add something else to your bingo card here on this Sunday, the 4th goal of the game for Guelph and 10th goal overall is now under review. So we'll look for some clarity on that.
Wonder who called that one.
Your guess on that one is as good as mine. This is the second time, apparently these two teams like high scoring games, the second time that these two teams have ever met up. The first of which was the opening game in what became a very memorable championship 1984-85 season. The first game back on November 3rd, 1984 here at the Fieldhouse was a 13-6 win for the Engineers over Guelph. And I mentioned to Dan Fridgen, and I was half kidding that I was 99% sure I was looking at hockey scores and not football scores. But we're approaching that kind of territory here in this one as RPI has already punched in their metaphorical touchdown. So the goal will stand after the review. Face off at center is won by Kutkevicius. Sent in deep, the net already empty at the faceoff, swept along by Nathan Sullivan. This one's rolling its way towards the net, but it missed just wide and instead will be icing. Boy, if we had two clears from the defensive end into empty nets, you could barely game plan for one, let alone two, but instead it's an offensive zone draw for the Griffins.
He didn't put the right roll on that one.
I don't know if that's a nod to who is the better of the two golfers, but advantage Smolinski on his ability to place a wedge.
I agree.
Now, there is another review. Only brief. The official's already coming back on the ice.
I think they're looking at the clock, that's all.
Okay. Thank you for the clarity on that.
Because off the opening draw, they put three more seconds on.
Face off to the right of Carson Cherepak's cage, Kutkevicius and Chicharello. A tie up off the draw. Pulled free by Strom, kept in at the line, shot through a screen, missed the net wide. Sullivan picks his head up, sends it ahead for John Evans, who will shoot towards the empty net. It's knocked up and over the net with now 10 seconds to go. Long outlet feed on the tape of DeSimone, who will shoot. Blocker save made by Cherepak with 5 seconds to go. Pass in front. Never got its way there. It's cleared to the far boards. One last chance. Cherepak will hang on. And the Engineers complete the victory. And naturally, as much of the third period saw, some final pleasantries being exchanged between the two sides in front of Cherepak's net as there was some pushing and shoving right at the final horn. But RPI hangs on to win. They finish off their season opening weekend with a shootout victory over Union and a 6-4 victory over the Griffins of the University of Guelph.
Yeah, so a good exhibition weekend, as you say, for RPI. And I'm thinking that one of the players for RPI picked up a penalty there. That was Sullivan at the end of the regulation, so he got on the scoreboard. Score sheet, I should say. On the score sheet. But no, good weekend to build off of, and a lot of positive things that you see there from this 23-24 RPI hockey squad.
There you go, and as we talked about in the opener yesterday against Union, you're looking for those positives and the systems and chemistry and things that you can build on for the remainder of the season. So positives abound here in Troy after one weekend here in 23-24. Yes, Coach?
I would like to wish all the viewers from Canada a happy Thanksgiving.
Oh.
It's Turkey Day.
I heard you're returning to the Frigian household and celebrating accordingly.
Yes, yes. We do have a bird in the oven.
Very nice. Well, a happy Thanksgiving to you, my good friend. And with that all being said, a happy Thanksgiving to all the Canadian viewers out there, both Guelph fans and RPI fans alike, if you've been watching this weekend on RPI TV. And we thank you for doing so. So again, the final score in this one, it was 6-4 in favor of RPI. It wasn't without its fair share of chances for the Griffins in the third period as they began to mount a comeback.
Yes, here's another, you know, the shot here goes off of the foot, trying to block the shot here, and you're in the right spot at the right time, going to the net. It's wide open for you.
Thank you very much to Jonah DeSimone, who at the time got the first goal of the game. That made it, at the time it was 5-1. There were a couple more on the visiting side, and then went into the empty net for Max Polinski. 6-4, your final here this weekend. So as we mentioned a bit earlier, the Engineers will go on a bit of a lengthy road trip coming up. They'll play 2 games against the University of Maine on the road next weekend, then 2 more road games against Boston College and Providence before opening up league play on November 3rd and 4th. With games against Union College, the Garnet Chargers, a game away in Schenectady on Friday, November 3rd, before opening up the regular season here at the Houston Fieldhouse against Union for the blackout game on November 4th. Meanwhile, we'll be back on the air this coming Friday evening when Brian Vines, Amanda Rampato, and the RPI Engineers women's hockey team will be back home. They take on Syracuse in a non-conference matchup. Go to rpiathletics.com for tickets and more information. But if you can't join us in the building, join us on the broadcast back on ESPN+. Well, for everybody working hard behind the scenes, and for my broadcast partner, Dan Fridge, and Dan Ball, saying thank you so much for watching and have a great rest of your weekend. You've been watching Engineers Hockey on ESPN+.